Yeah, then let's begin. So thanks. Well, thanks for the invitation. And today I'm going to talk about a geometric perspective on hydrodynamic PDE. And this is joined and based on a paper by together with Mario Morelli from Milano and Klaas Modin from Gothenburg. And so what I want to be talking about today is certain stochastic partial differential equations from fluid dynamics. And let's first motivate why is one interested in these stochastic models from hydrodynamics. And so here's a nice picture, which is stolen from a paper by Krieser and Flandoli and Holm. This is not my picture. Basically, they are looking at a model for the ocean surface, where you have a certain number of buoys. So that's what these strange colors are showing. So basically, you have buoys floating in the ocean. You get positional data. You get lots of positional data over many months and probably years. And you try to come up with a model of the surface of the ocean. Modeling, for example, with Euler's equation. And the reason, when you ask, for example, Holm, why he's doing that, one reason for that is that so there's data uncertainty in the large data set they have. And to accommodate for that, you can, for example, use a stochastic term to accommodate for these data uncertainties. And at least this is sort of what their first paper claims on it. And if you on this, and if you ask Dan Krizan for another reason why should you be interested in these stochastic versions of equations from fluid dynamics, so he has some very nice numerical experiments in which he shows that you can simulate, for example, Euler's equation on a very coarse grid. If you add noise there, then you get the same qualitative behavior as if you simulate the Euler equation on a very fine grid. So in a way, the choosing the right stochastic term is giving you the same behavior of the coarse in the coarse approximation than in the fine approximation. So you can potentially, if you do it right, save a lot of computational time when you want to do numerics for these models. Okay, so basically for us, the story started with these papers by Krieser, Flandoli, and Holm. And we were asked, I mean, none of the people involved here is sort of a traditional PDE person. We want, or I mean, Mario is a traditional SPDE person, but what we wanted to do, we want to use geometry to solve this problem, or at least parts of the problem. And our aim is to get local well-postedness for these stochastic equations by geometric means. And before I'm explaining that, let's first have a look at the deterministic setting. So the first part of the talk will be sort of a recollection and or an introduction to how do you do this with the PDE part of the equation. So there will be nothing stochastic in this part of the talk. And so we'll insert stochastic stuff later. But basically, our general setting is as follows. So K will always be a compact manifold. D will be the dimension of this manifold, and we'll choose a Riemannian metric and a volume form associated with this Riemannian metric. And also the manifold is allowed to have a smooth boundary, but I'm dropping always this boundary stuff under the table. The reason for that being that usually you have to care what is happening at the boundary, and this is just getting technical. So I'm giving you a cartoon version where usually I'm to just be able to nicely state everything. I'll be not having boundaries whatsoever. And since I know we have a diverse audience here, if you don't normally think about manifolds and you don't like manifolds, just so if you don't like manifolds, think during the whole talk, K is some bounded area in RD, right? And so if in case you don't like manifolds and you probably also don't like Riemannian metrics, then just think of the Riemannian metric as being the standard Euclidean inner product. And the integrals you have there as a standard multidimensional integral you have against on flat space. All right. So basically, we need this Riemannian structure to describe the usual differential operators we have in our example we care most about, which is the Euler equation. So in our paper, we only deal with the Euler equation. But in case you don't like manifolds, just replace everything in your thoughts with the usual differential operators, which you might know on RD. Yeah, so there's nothing really intrinsic manifoldish happening here at this stage. So everything can be formulated on RD. All right. So basically, there is the so-called Euler equation for an incompressible fluid in such a domain, which is given as a partial differential equation. So we are searching for a vector field U. And the U, yes? What's the question? Okay, doesn't seem to be the case. So basically, I want to sort of the time, so U is a time-dependent vector field. I want, and the equation reads sort of, you take the time derivative of U. I use the subscript T not in the physics notation to indicate another time derivative. So this is just there to remind you that the U depends on time, right? So it's not just something in the spatial variables, but also in a time variable. So, and basically the Euler equation for an incompressible fluid governs how this incompressible fluid will develop over time in your spatial domain K, and you have basically the time derivative of U plus this term grad U T U T, which is sort of something like you on flat space you would have the derivative of U, and you you bracket with the inner product the component with the derivative and multiply them together and sum up afterwards, right? And on the right hand side you have minus the gradient of our pressure function rho, which is also time dependent and spatial dependent, and possibly if you want to make things a little bit more interesting, you have another forcing term. So we later see the forcing term, and then you are asking for the vector field to be divergence free. And some initial conditions. So this is just the classical Euler equation, right. So now I want to explain what this Euler equation has to do with infinite dimensional manifolds, right? I mean, so far, everything, so we have a compact manifold, everything is finite dimensional, we have a domain in RD, there are no infinite dimensional manifolds around here. So how, at least when you've read the abstract, there are somehow infinite dimensional manifolds coming into play. What is the meaning of this? Why should this equation be somehow related to infinite dimensional things? Okay, so let's have a look at this. So basically the idea which goes back to Arnold is the following. So we are searching for this vector field which solves our differential equation. This is the so-called Eulerian viewpoint. But equivalently, we can also switch to Lagrangian viewpoint. So searching instead of the flow of this vector field. So we are searching for a flow curve which says eta dot is equal to u evaluated at eta. And switching to this Lagrangian point of view is what will bring us from finite dimensions to infinite dimensions. Okay. And as I said, this was discovered by Arnold back in a paper in 66, who uncovered that certain PDEs, so it doesn't work for every PDE, but a large class of the PDEs from hydrodynamics can be viewed as ODEs, but on an infinite dimensional manifold. And the main idea here is, how do you arrive at this infinite dimensional manifold? So you basically want to shift from the Eulerian to the Lagrangian point of view. So by looking at the flow, so formally the flow is something which lives on some sort of time interval J times our underlying manifold K and takes values in K. And just for argument's sake, let's pretend for a moment that this flow here is C-infinity function, right? So in general, we won't have that. Depends on the right-hand, on the vector field we are starting with, initial conditions of this. But what can you do if you have a mapping of these two variables? So we can basically define a new map. And let's call this eta v. And basically, I want to define a map from J with values in the smooth functions from K to K. And how do you do this? You basically say, okay, time gets sent to eta of t. And then I refuse to evaluate in the second component. So basically, when once I've chosen time, this becomes a smooth mapping, mapping k into k. So it becomes, just formally speaking, an element in the smooth functions from k to k, just by the definition. The computer scientists like to call this operation the currying operation, due to some computer scientist whose name was apparently Curry. And so this gives rise in a natural way. So you start with a function which eats two variables, and you get a function which takes one variable and spits out a function again of one variable once you've fixed that. And so this guy here on the right-hand side, so the C-infinity functions from k to k, they will turn out to be an infinite dimensional manifold. And this is sort of the little trick you can use to lift this PDE, Euler's equation, from a finite dimensional manifold to something which now evolves on an infinite dimensional manifold. And of course, technically, this is sort of a bit more demanding. So one thing which you certainly want, so you start with a smooth map from J times K with values in K, and then you take the eta V. And what you want to know is, of course, so we have the C-infinity manifold on the right-hand side, which is now an infinite dimension manifold. It's a manifold of mappings. And one question one may ask, we started with a smooth eta. Does this automatically entail that this eta V is a smooth mapping into this manifolds of mapping? So does it become a smooth curve with values in an infinite dimensional manifold? And there's the so-called exponential law for smooth maps, which states that the eta is smooth if and only if the eta V is smooth. So this is actually quite pleasing, because then we can sort of relegate smoothness on the finite dimension level, so of the smoothness of the map eta, to the smoothness of a curve on an infinite dimensional manifold by hiding the spatial variable. I am giving you here, again, a cartoon version of this story. So there's actually a little bit more to it. But so in case you have seen this before, or have seen people talking about the exponential law before, the crucial property we are exploiting here for such a thing to be true is actually compactness of this manifold K. So this is also the main reason why we need compactness of the underlying spatial domain. If we don't have that, then on one hand, things get more ugly, and I would say that at least without major modifications, all of these techniques won't work. The techniques I'm going to show you we are using to solve this problem. However, so let's assume now a little bit more. Let's assume that the eta is the flow of a divergence-free vector field. So once we freeze time, so the eta with the lowercase t now means we have chosen a time t in our interval j. So then we get a C-infinity mapping from k to k. However, since we know that this is the flow of a vector field, as soon as this is defined for all the points in k, and we always have this for at least small enough time intervals, then we know that actually once we freeze time, we get a diffeomorphism from k to k. So it's actually an invertible map. This is due to the flow property. And moreover, since the vector field we started from was divergence free, what you can prove is that the resulting diffeomorphism is volume preserving. So it preserves the given volume form on your manifold. And basically, the upshot of the whole game is when we start with the flow of a solution of Euler's equation, then the resulting flow map gives rise to this eta wedge, and this is now a curve on the volume-preserving diffeomorphisms, right? And so diff here means smooth diffeomorphisms. All right. So basically, we can cook up from a solution of Euler's equation, can we cook up a special curve in the volume-preserving diffeomorphisms. Okay, so let's see. And let me now humor you, and let's start to derivate this curve. So we have this eta v. This is something from J with values in diff mu k. And so let's see. So this is a curve. What happens if I take a time derivative of this? So this whole game with the exponential law boils down to, this is actually the same as I take the partial derivative in time of the eta. Well, eta is some, and then I wedge this guy. Right? Okay. Or in other words, we know since d dt eta is given as u of t, probably I should write t here, ut eta t. So I'm suppressing everywhere the spatial components. So this is basically saying us we can identify this with such a curve. Well, actually, I have to wedge this. So this wants to eat still a spatial component. And if I do it two times, so then I get, well, I get to do this guy two times. So this is d dt u of t eta t. Wedge, and basically, if you believe me that we can just take the partial derivative, sorry, shouldn't write it like this. If I want to write partial derivative, then the bracket is wrong. So basically, if I want to write expresses of the partial derivative, I go to the finite dimensional, compute a partial derivative, and then wedge whatever I get there. And the upshot of this whole thing, when you do the calculations, so let's assume u is a solution to Euler's equation. What you get then is when you run through, so you take, you use a chain rule just on the finite dimension one, you look at the terms which appear, and it turns out that if you take the derivative here, you get the left-hand side of Euler's equation evaluated up to at a point eta t of some starting value put in there. So in the end, what you get here by Euler's equation, you get that the result is minus the gradient of the pressure function you have there. And then formally, I need to identify everything, and then need to put a v here. Okay, well, so on one hand, so where are we now? Basically, we say, okay, we want actually to solve Euler's equation. So we are searching for the vector field u. If we instead of searching for u, we can instead also search for the eta, so the flow of the u. And if we assume that that our eta is associated to the to a solution of Euler's equation, then we see that we can cook up at least twice differentiable curve with values in the volume preserving diffeomorphisms, such that the second derivative is given by minus the gradient of some function. Basically, that's what this equation says. Okay, so, and now comes sort of the next insight of Arnold. So we have basically, what Arnold is saying is, okay, we know now that the second partial derivative in time of the flow is minus the gradient of rho. Oh, actually, I was missing inserted with the flow again. And what does it mean? So there's something on manifolds which is called Hodge theory. And Hodge theory tells you that everything which can be written as a gradient of some function, doesn't matter what the function is, this is orthogonal in the with respect to the L2 inner product to the space of divergence-free vector fields. Okay, why is this interesting? So, as I said, we know that this curve, eta t or eta v, takes values in the diffeomorphism group, in the volume-preserving diffeomorphism group, right? And we know that dt squared of eta, if we wedge this, this is dt square. Ah, there seems to be a question. No. Of the eta v. And so this is orthogonal in the L2 sense to the volume preserving diffeomorphism, volume to the divergence free vector fields on the K. And this is now interesting because what you can prove is the volume preserving diffeomorphisms, they form an infinite dimensional Lie group. And tangent spaces, or let's formulate it like this, the Lie algebra of this infinite dimension Lie group is given by these divergence-free vector fields. So to summarize this, we have a two times differentiable curve into an infinite dimensional manifold whose second derivative is L2 orthogonal to the tangent space of the submanifold of the manifold of all smooth functions. Okay, and basically, when you recall a little bit about Riemannian geometry, what this actually implies when you want to calculate what this eta wedge is as a curve into the divergence, the volume-preserving diffeomorphisms, then this means nothing else than the eta wedge becomes a geodesic with respect to the L2 Riemannian metric on the diffeomorphism group, right? And so this is what Arnold observed. So he basically said, well, instead of solving Euler's equation, I can just solve the geodesic equation on this infinite dimension manifold. Geodesic equations are just second order ODEs. And then we are basically done, right? So second order ODEs, we can solve them by ODE techniques on the infinite dimension manifold. And this is much easier than if we want to get local well-postness for Euler's equation. This is really the idea due to Arnold. And the reason why equations for which this trick works are nowadays called Euler-Arnold equations. Okay, so this is a nice idea. Euler's equation apparently becomes an ODE on an infinite dimension manifold. So let's hit everything with ODE techniques and get local well-postness from this. I mean, what I exhibited up to now is if you start with Euler's equation with a PDE, you can cook up this geodesic equation and you see that solutions of Euler's equation actually give rise to solutions of the ODE on the infinite dimensional manifold. What you have to prove, and in the deterministic setting, this is a fairly short little lemma. If you have a solution to the geodesic equation, you can also cook up a solution to the PDE. So this actually goes both ways. You can go from finite dimensions, from the PDE to an infinite dimensional manifold, get an ODE, and if you start with the right ODE on the infinite dimension manifold, you can cook up a PDE or a solution to the PDE you were originally interested in. Okay, Fair enough. So we have this nice idea. The problem comes now. So this group diffmuk, or the volume preserving diffeomorphism, they are not modeled on a Banach space. So they are not a Banach manifold. And you might have, depending on what your background is, so ODE theory works very nicely up to Banach space realms. So where you, basically you want sort of a version of Picard-Lindelöf, for example, which gives you local existence and uniqueness of solutions. And this works in Banach spaces and also on Banach manifolds, but breaks down beyond Banach spaces. Now, unfortunately, this diffmuk is not a Banach manifold. It's a little bit worse, so it's modeled on a completely metrizable space, but not on a Banach space. You cannot norm it. That's the main issue. And at this point, you can say, okay, well, it was a nice idea, but that's it for us. So we are getting out here, so there's no way we can make this work.
Is this because of the C infinity space that you don't have Banach space structure? Okay.
Yeah, thank you very much. You're actually stealing sort of the point of my next slide. So exactly, the problem arises here, and this was sort of solved by Eben and Marston. The problem is that that we are dealing with C infinity functions, and C infinity functions cannot be normed because you have to control infinitely many derivatives. So this gives rise naturally to a Fréchet topology. So what Eben and Marston in their seminal paper from 69 proposed is, well, instead of lifting everything to the smooth diffeomorphisms, let's use instead Sobolev type mappings with L2 derivatives, where the Sobolev index is above the critical Sobolev index, so that you actually get a group of Sobolev type diffeomorphisms. And if you do this, you obtain a much nicer manifold. This is a Hilbert manifold. What you lose a little bit, because this the Sobolev type diffeomorphisms are no longer a Lie group. Remember, I said this group of smooth volume preserving diffeomorphisms is a Lie group. This is no longer true for the Sobolev type diffeomorphisms. You only get something which is called a half Lie group. So the geometry gets worse, but at least you can hit everything with ODE theory.
Alexander? With,
yes?
In your story so far, was it important that the volume preserving diffeomorphisms are a Lie group?
Yes. So it wasn't apparent why this was important. And it will not play a big role in this talk, because I'm sort of sweeping all the technical details under the rug. When you look into the technical solution to this problem I was just pointing out, let me just give you sort of an impression why it might be important to probably not working on a Lie group, but to have more structure there. So a geodesic equation can be formulated using the spray of a metric. So there's a metric spray. And if you do this, so if you're familiar with finite dimensional Riemannian geometry, the spray is sort of what is another formulation of what people in finite dimensions often like to express using Christoffel symbols. Basically, there's a spray, and so the geodesic equation with the spray becomes eta dot dot should be the same as S of eta dot. So the spray gives you the right hand side, and what you want is, so obviously, we want S to be smooth. Or at least, let's say perhaps at least Lipschitz or C1 or something, to hit everything with standard ODE theory. Right. So if we know that the right-hand side of our ODE is given by smooth enough coefficients, then we can hit it by the standard solution theory to deduce that there is a solution, and that this and the differentiability class of the solution, and so forth. So there's another problem in this setting in infinite dimensions. smoothness of S is not automatic. So in finite dimensions, whenever you have a Riemannian metric, there are so one of the standard proofs in Riemannian geometry will then show you that the spray is always smooth. In infinite dimensions, this is unfortunately not the case, and this is what makes this Eben-Marsden paper I was already referring to so long, because part of the hard analytic work they were doing is to show that the spray is actually smooth for the L2 metric on the volume preserving diffeomorphisms. And an integral ingredient of the whole business of how you show smoothness of the spray is to realize that the L2 metric on the volume preserving diffeomorphisms is right invariant with respect to the group product, and to exploit this right invariance. And
for that, it doesn't help that you have an action of kind of the Lie group of smooth diffeomorphisms on the non Lie group of Sobolev diffeomorphisms.
No, at least in the. No, it's a short answer. So you really want this? You want to smear around the spray using the thing from the right.
You need a transitive action for that as well.
Yes, and in the end, I mean, sort of the nice thing about this whole technique is, in the end, it turns out that you can make do with this HS Sobolev morphisms, and you don't need smoothness of the group operation. You can still smear it around. This will only be continuous, and then the miracle in the Eben-Marsden paper is actually that something which from first principles shouldn't be smooth, because you are using non-smooth operations like the group operation to smear stuff around, is actually smooth, because in the derivation of why this spray S here is smooth, sort of the non-smooth parts cancel. Yeah, so it looks like a little bit like a miracle when you're looking at these things from the outside. Okay.
Thanks.
But these things can be managed, and this is sort of where geometric arguments and analytic arguments are going in. And what Eben and Marsden do, they obtain local well-postness for Euler's equation and continuous parameter dependence by infinite dimensional ODE techniques. And the nice thing is this can be seen as a strength and a weakness at the same time of these techniques. So this is completely agnostic of the underlying manifold. So the only thing which you use is that the underlying manifold K is compact, and that you have a choice of Riemannian metric. But apart from this, the same argument goes through for every compact manifold, also independent of dimensions. So it doesn't matter whether you have a two-dimensional, three-dimensional, four-dimensional manifold, or even higher dimensional. In principle, this gives you local well-postness of Euler's equation. This is sort of a strength, but it comes at a price. So nowadays, when you ask PDE people how do you show local well-postness, they will not say, "Well, we use this trick by Arnold and rewrite this as some ODE and so forth." Instead, they will tell you, "Well, we'll do, for example, some sort of energy estimate and do some estimates with pure PDE techniques and so forth." If you do these estimates, then of course you have an estimate which gives you much more control about the situation, and then usually also more or other useful information about the PDE. This is nothing you can get with these Euler-Arnold techniques, right? But once you've done the geometry, it's actually quite elegant, because you're not forced to do estimates anywhere. Yeah? So this is, it's just about, can you get it to a situation where you can hit it with ODE techniques? Right. So the further nice observation, this is not special for the Euler equation. So I was telling you the story for the Euler equation, but a similar approach works for every one of these Euler-Arnold PDEs. So I'm not sure how much this will tell you, because I don't know whether there's sort of a PDE audience here. But so other famous equations in this class are, for example, Kamassa-Holm, Hunter-Sexton, and Berger's equation. Those are other PDEs for which has been demonstrated that exactly the same techniques lead to a local existence and uniqueness result. Okay, but as I said, this is all theory of perhaps the 70s and at most the 80s. So there was nothing stochastic going on here, and so this is the new thing we bring to the table. We're actually
Alex. Sorry, before yes? you start with the stochastic part, I have a question kind of like concerning the setting. So you mentioned that kind of like you need smoothness of your solutions, right? Or at least some Sobolev type. So can you kind of like, is there also a formalism which kind of like takes into account more general kind of like concepts of solutions, like multi-valued solutions of your PDE?
Not to my knowledge, no. So this is another restriction. So the solutions you get here are strong in the PDE sense. So you don't get any sort of weak solutions beyond wave breaking or something like that. So this is sort of like getting classical solutions, and then this theory can't predict what happens after explosion time. At least to my knowledge. So if anybody has an idea how to accommodate weak solutions in the setting, that would be quite interesting, but so far I don't know. So at least I don't know any papers where this has been done in the deterministic setting. What people have been doing traditionally, they have been able to give, beyond this pure local existence and uniqueness business, they have been able to find interesting geometric identities which tell you something about the qualitative behavior of your equations. So there are works also from the 2000s where this has been done, for example, for Hunter-Sexton, where you rewrite Hunter-Sexton as an ODE on a sphere in a Hilbert space, for example. And, such things are possible with this theory. It comes at a certain cost, but the upshot is that you can use geometry to do these calculations without employing traditional PDE methods. All right. So now what we've been doing, and this is sort of what I want to tell you in the last, say, 10 minutes or something, we can do a stochastic version of these things, we have a stochastic version of Euler's equation. But what I claim is that this works again for lots of these equations of the Euler-Arnold type. And the setting is always the same. So we transform our stochastic Euler-Arnold PDE in Lagrangian formulation. So we want to solve for the flow. And this then becomes a stochastic differential equation on an infinite dimensional manifold, which at least in the first paper is always the same structure. So you have on the left-hand side a part which is the Euler-Arnold PDE. So you have the PDE part, and then you have an additive noise term. What do I mean by all of this? So on the right-hand side, so this dW, this should signify a stochastic integral on the right-hand side. So the circle there is the usual notation for a Stratonovich integral. So in case you have seen it, or in case you haven't seen it, there when you integrate against Brownian motion or a stochastic noise term, there are several ways of how you can define your stochastic integral, and the Stratonovich noise is one of them. Stratonovich.
Why do you call this additive noise? Because this is multiplicative noise.
That depends a lot on your position. what is actually happening? Yeah. So, this is additive in the following sense. If you pass to the vector field formulation of this, you see that this actually corresponds in the vector field picture to adding a stochastic force to the vector field.
Okay, I see.
So and thus it is sort of additive. I mean, it's a bit hidden now in the Lagrangian formulation, because when you pass the Lagrangian, sort of, you have this you basically have something which looks like a composition of the flow with the stochastic field.
But if you would start with a multiplicative noise for the vector field, what would happen then?
Yeah, so this is I come to that. So in our first paper, we only do this additive noise. The reason is because this is giving you a very nice geometric structure of your equation on the infinite dimensional manifold. So it's basically a very simple SDE you get then in the end. And when we were approaching this for the first time, we thought that it's imperative that we have this structure for our equation on the infinite dimensional manifold. So this is sort of part of the work in progress part. We have done some calculations now with more involved noise. I mean, this additive noise is really sort of, from the perspective of the theory, is the simplest noise. I mean, basically, everything which you can think of as nice properties you want of your noise, this additive noise more or less has it. And of course, it would be interesting to do, for example, multiplicative noise or... for example, Daryl Holm in his paper, he's not doing additive noise and he's not doing multiplicative noise. He's doing something he calls lead transport noise, which is more involved. So there's more interfacing between the PDE terms and the stochastic noise terms. And first, I mean, when we were writing the first paper, we thought we need the special structure of the noise to derive our equations on the infinite dimension manifold and to say something sensible. After some further calculations, we are more or less convinced that this is not true. So we think we can do also more involved and more interesting noises by analyzing more carefully what the equation on the infinite dimensional space is doing. Okay, but let's see. So we have this additive noise. And okay, so this is sort of the old picture, what is happening in the first paper. So you have basically you have this Eben-Marsden approach, and this is really amenable to additive terms. Basically, the drift or the deterministic PDE part is taken care of by classical Eben-Marsden theory, and then you only have to take care of the diffusion coefficients on the right hand side and solve an SDE on a Hilbert manifold. And so the upshot here is that this is, I mean, when you look into the Holm paper, so they are only taking a finite sum downstairs here in the noise term, whereas it actually makes no difference from if you're taking an infinite sum. Obviously, you want this to converge in the right Hilbert space. So you, I mean, what I'm hiding here for this infinite dimension noise, for this infinite sum, or if it's an infinite sum, you need to ask for a summability condition. If you've seen stochastic terms on Hilbert spaces, this is basically asking for something like a trace class condition on the noise coefficients. All right, but in principle, you can do intrinsic infinite dimensional noise. And then the theorem you get out of this, or the first theorem we got in our paper, is, so if you fix Sobolev exponent over the critical one, and you start with some noise term, which is a little bit better, and namely a sort of critical exponent plus 2, then the Lagrangian form of Euler's equation is locally well posed, so it admits a locally unique solution. Right, and let me give you the second part of the theorem. So if the noise is even better, so if it's in the class S plus 4, then the local well-posedness results holds also for the stochastic Euler equation. This is basically going from the Lagrangian formulation back to the Eulerian formulation. So you're losing a few degrees of regularity. What I should say here, both of these results, so the W dot, so in the regularity in 1 and the regularity in 2, is not optimal. Indeed, it's much too strong. When you look at it from the perspective of the stochastic papers written in this direction. So what I mean by that is there are sort of SPDE papers which analyze the situation with SPDE methods on a fixed manifold, for example, on the torus or something in 3D. And what they can do is basically they their result, which is, I think, essentially sharp, is basically you can throw away the +2 and the +4 in both of the formulations. That should be the SPDE result. So far, this is not what we had in the first paper, and to a certain degree that was on purpose, because what we are showing in our first paper is sort of the easiest version of these results. So what Mario Morelli is quite confident that if you look closer at the regularity of these coefficients by using sort of let's say standard stochastic techniques, sort of regularization techniques, he's pretty sure that he can get rid of the superfluous orders of regularity we need to make this theorem work. So he's sure that in the end one should be able to improve this theorem to everything should be in the divergence-free vector fields of class S and not S+2 and S+4. But we haven't done this in the first paper. Right. So the regularity here is not optimal. However, all of these results are agnostic of the underlying manifold. So the dimension of it is arbitrary again. There's boundary allowed. Okay, so this is a fairly general result. Again, at the price that you don't get, for example, nice energy estimates or something like this, which you would get if you treat it in the traditional SPDE setting. So this is in first approximation only giving you this local well postness result.
Just a question. So if you say local well postness, you mean up to a stopping time, I guess?
Yes. Yes, so I didn't want to go into the technicals, but this is exactly what we prove. There exists a stopping time, the usual setting in principle, yes. Yeah. Okay, and sort of the nice thing which you have to deal with in the result is basically you have a Stratonovich type SDE on a Hilbert manifold for which existence and uniqueness of solutions depending on the coefficients is well known. I mean, this is sort of standard theory from infinite dimensional stochastic analysis, if you want. Probably I should just briefly go back to the last slide and come back to Bas' question. So the reason why, when you are doing it naively, need S+2 and S+4 is buried in the regularity assumptions on the diffusion coefficients. And these diffusion coefficients, so the diffusion coefficients are the stuff you are multiplying with the white noise, they need to be, for the stochastic chain rules, to be C2. When you go through how these diffusion coefficients are constructed, this actually exploits the group product on the Sobolev type diffeomorphisms. And unfortunately, the group product is not smooth, since this is not a Lie group, so it's only a half Lie group. But what you can prove, at least for these Sobolev type diffeomorphisms, if what you're multiplying is better than just being Sobolev HS, then the product also inherits differentiability properties from the additional differentiability of the stuff you're multiplying. So the general rule of thumb is if you want the product to be a C2 map on the Sobolev type manifold, you need two orders of regularity more in the initial conditions. And this is exactly the source of where here in the first part of the theorem the +2 is coming from, because we want our diffusion coefficients to be at least C2. Okay. Right, so you have to deal with SDE on Hilbert manifolds. So this exploits the group operation. So an integral part of this whole business is right invariance of the noise term. So you're basically, actually what we are doing when you look closely in the paper, we are constructing a noise on a Hilbert space, which is sort of the tangent space of the diff HS group at the identity. And then we are propagating the noise by multiplying it from the right all over this this group, right? So this is a geometric way of building a noise term. And once you have done this, so you have these three ingredients, so you need to analyze the regularity of the noise. And this is sort of where the group product and regularity of the underlying Lie group plays a, half Lie group, I should say, plays a role. Okay. Yes, right. So reminder to myself, if HS is not a Lie group, so you basically have to be careful, and this is where the additional regularity is coming from. And sort of what we are doing at the moment, so we, I mean, as I said, so this is not bounded to the Euler equation, but you can do it basically for everyone from this Euler-Arnold family. And these techniques go through with minor modifications to, say, for example, Kamasa-Holm. I mean, Kamasa-Holm is really sort of the simplest case. There you can almost copy all of this stuff we've done for Euler without changing anything. So the only thing you have to rub out everywhere that it's sort of Kamasa-Holm is developing on the diffeomorphism group, not on the volume preserving diffeomorphism group. So you have to cancel out everywhere the mu, basically. It's not entirely true, but to give you a flavor. There's something called the no loss, no gain theorem from standard Eben-Marsden. For this, you have to work more. We think we have a proof for this now. What this means is, so once I've lifted my Euler equation to the infinite dimension manifold, I can choose, basically, as long as I stay over the critical Sobolev exponent, do I solve this in the HS morphisms, or do I solve this in the HS plus one morphisms, or even in higher regularity? And from the outset, it might be that your solution, for example, the time of existence of the solution, depends on the space you're solving in. So if you're solving in, say, you're starting with an HS plus K regular initial value, but you're solving in the space of HS diffeomorphisms. I mean, a priori, it might be, because it's a larger space, that the solution exists for a longer interval of time because you're solving in the space of worse morphisms. But it turns out, at least this is sort of the gist of the no loss, no gain theorem, at least in the deterministic setting, this is not true. So whenever you can write this as an equation on one of the HS spaces, the solution is the same as on every other HS space where this equation makes sense. And we think we can do this also now for the stochastic versions, but this is not in the first paper. And then finally, sort of the important question is, can we do more interesting noises? So for example, multiplicative noises was already mentioned, or this Lie transport noises Holm and co-authors are looking into. Okay. As I said, this is work in progress. And so the only thing I have to say, you know, thanks for the attention. So this is the reference to our paper, and sort of the Krizan, Flandoli, and Holm paper you can find also on the archive.
Thank you very much.